we're at the point where we're beginning the final assembly of the pilot on locomotive 100. What we have done so far is we have attached the two angle irons permanently. They're secured in place now, and we're beginning to dry fit the triangle, which is the base of the pilot, so that we can scribe marks and bore the necessary holes. Shortly, we'll be bolting this in place, and then we can begin the process of bolting the individual teeth in place. So we're at the beginning of approximately, I'd say, a 3.5 to 4 hour process of final assembly on the pilot for car 100 on this end.
Yep. Great.
Okay, we're at the stage now where we're beginning to put the frame in place. We've got the T-frame bolted together. You may be able to tell that the bolts that are in place right now have not yet been painted. They'll be painted shortly as a preservative. The upright that you can see here has a hole down that's in place. And if you look at this one closely, this one that's in my hand is the original cast iron tie down from over 100 years ago. The threads on it had completely eroded away, and the threads had been welded on from a modern day bolt. Two new ones had to be fabricated because two of them had just completely and totally disappeared. But what happens now is we have the upright temporarily in place. We have the horizontal that's going to be going right here. And then once we have the horizontal secured in place with the lag bolts, then we begin the process of putting the teeth in place. And here we have the outside tooth right there. And then there are seven more teeth that fit into this, and then the step is in the center. So the process is not rocket science, but it's very tedious and time consuming.
Morning.
We're scraping all the paint off of the side, the wainscoting of 100. And much to our surprise and pleasure, we found the number one under here. 8.5 inches high, and the vertical part is about, depending on how you measure it, approximately 2 inches with 5/8 inch serifs. We expect that the whole thing will be about down here, about 3.5. We're looking for the next pieces that go along with it. This is over the brown. So this was what the locomotive was when it came to us, was silver lettering. And if you look at the old pictures, it seems to show up. Now, we also found something we had no idea was there. There is the yellow stripe, and we found that this forms a box. In other words, this is the top of the piece, and approximately 2 inches to the center, and we're going to measure this in a minute a little more carefully, is a yellow stripe that continues across all of these pieces, and then it comes down the side. It's about 1/2 inch wide, and we'll, as we get clearer images, we will get some more accurate measurements here, so stay tuned. We're looking at the left-hand side of 100's wainscoting for the cab, and we're discovering on it a bit of history that we did not know existed. We're finding, as we pointed out a little while ago, that there was a gold or yellow stripe approximately 2 inches from the bottom, and about 2 inches from the top board, which was covered, that went all the way around this panel. Now, we looked at that same panel in this photograph, which is 1907, which if this was the first paint on the wood, which it seems to be after the initial color, that you'd think it would show up. Well, it doesn't. This line and this line is the frame of the actual cab and the hoods. So the stripe, if it were there, would show up here, would show up all around. So it doesn't do it. Then something else shows up in here, in the center. There's this border, which is quite professionally done, which is perhaps better than you would get in something like a small country trolley line like the Atlantic Shore. And it goes way over to here, and there's a rounded edge with appears to have a black outline and comes back. Over here, there's another little something that we can't really see too much of. But my thought is on all of that bordering is that this may be a car that was ordered by somebody else or painted by somebody for something else. And then they changed their mind and the Atlantic Shoreline bought it, because this does not appear in any pictures that we have. And we've never even heard of it being there. This, I think, is the first time it's ever been brought to light in 102 years. So that's a theory anyway. Now, as we move over, we find that the numbers on here are, after you look at them enough times and you begin to do some measurements. Was this the one?
Yep.
Okay. This is 1940, and it's fairly easy to do them. We know the height. That was easy to find. That's 8.5 inches. But we find that if we measure, these boards are about 3 1/8 inch wide. So we were able to space this out and get the actual width of the numbers quite well. And so as we laid out our rules and so forth here, we measure. We're looking at the construction of the wainscoting here, and we, after a lot of thinking about it, we came up with a theory, which I think is correct because I thought of it. This is the edge of the panel, which is composed of 22 pieces of tongue and groove, about 3 1/1, let's get it exact, 3 1/8 inch face, 3 3/8 inch face. This one has no tongue on it. This one has a tongue and groove. We want to start that over again.
No, we're good.
This has a tongue and groove, and you go all the way along for 11 boards, and you come to the center. Two grooves. Then you move along all the way, another 11 boards, actually 10 boards, and then the 11th board has no tongue on the outside, but it's the tongues are all pointing this direction. And the reason for this is like when you put a floor down with tiles or you put ceiling tiles up, you start in the center. And in order to make things come out right so that you don't end up with half a piece on one end, they would make them whatever they come out to be on the end. And here you would insert a spline which would serve the purpose of a double tongue. On the roof of cars, we have noticed this. On the top, in the center, and we did this on Open 303 several many years ago. The center board has two tongues on it, and then when you get out to the edge, you have all the tongues pointing toward the either edge. So this is the same sort of idea here, just to make it so that it's aesthetically pleasing.